David's journey, to the desert, he came to a growing tree, sat down on a branch and prayed that he might die. I had enough for it, he said. Take my life. I am no better than my ancestors. Then he lay down under a tree and fell asleep. All at once, an angel touched him and said, "Get up and eat." He looked around, and there by his head was a cake of bread, baked over hot coals, and a jar of wine. He ate and he drank, and he lay down again. The angel of the Lord came back a second time and touched him and said, "Get up and eat, for the journey is too much for you." So he got up and ate, struggling by the food, and traveled 4 days and 4 nights until he reached Horeb, the mountain of God. God's
word.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I will read John chapter 6, verses 41 to 51.
Got it.
At this, the Jews began to grumble about him because he said, "I am the bread that came down from heaven." They said, "Is this not Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How can he now say, 'I came down from heaven'?" "Stop grumbling among yourselves," Jesus answered. "No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up at the last day."
Amen.
It is written in prophets, "They will all be taught by God. Everyone who listens to the Father and learns from him comes to me."
Amen.
"No one has seen the Father except the one who is from God. Only he has seen the Father."
Amen.
"I tell you the truth, he who believes has everlasting life. I am the bread of life. Your forefathers ate the manna in the desert, yet they died. But here is the bread that comes down from heaven, which a man may eat and not die. I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. This bread is my flesh, which I will give for the life of the world."
The pledge sheets for the church anniversary are still available in the narthex, And the congregational surveys are due back in today. There is a box on the table in the narthex. Also today, Pastor Black will be preaching at Mount Pleasant AME Church in Estill. And this is Reverend Barbara Terry's church. The choir and congregation are invited. And that will be today at 4 p.m. at Mount Pleasant AME in Estill, South Carolina. On Sunday, August 23rd, will be the Women's Missionary Annual Day at 3 p.m. And Reverend Willie Ann Hamilton will be the preacher. And that will be speaking. And that will be here at the church on August 23rd. Saturday, August 29th at 8:30 a.m. is the South Carolina Conference Branch YPD End of Year Meeting at Emmanuel AME Church. Any youth will be attending. Please see me as soon as possible so we can set up our transportation. And that will be Saturday, August 29th at 8:30. Please see me as soon as possible so we can get transportation. On Sunday, August 30th at 4 p.m., the Buford District Closing Conference Worship Service will be held at St. Stephen's AME Church in Hardyville. And that is all of my announcements. Please let us remember our sick and shut-in members with a prayer and also with the call. Have a great week.
Just in case we have any visitors that did not feel comfortable standing, just to show everybody a nice Campbell chapel ball. Looks like you had a long week. That's okay, you're in the right place.
Amen.
Before I give my expressions, I think we need to warm the place up a little bit. The only way to do that is just to take a moment of fellowship. So let me introduce you to the person sitting next to you. If it's a female, you know who she is. She is a daughter of the Most High God. And let me just say this, the more you see God in her, the higher God's going to elevate you.
Amen.
Now, if that's a male,
yeah.
He is a son of the Most High God. Now,
yeah.
you may not be able to see, because he might be like Jesus was. They couldn't see that he was the Messiah in that text that you read from John, because they knew his dad and his mom.
Amen.
You might have known that person all your life, but there's still daughter. First, I'm going to ask for everyone that sung on the biennial choir, please stand. If you were one of the singers on the biennial choir, are there any that aren't here today? Brother Hunt. These folks did an extraordinary job. I didn't want to leave their names out. Never hear from them again. Can you receive that?
Amen.
That's pretty bad, I understand. But I want to explain that note. At this time, we're going to worship the Lord for forgiving. We've got a wonderful choir behind us. They're ready to go. Our ushers are going to come forward. We're going to receive your offerings that you prepared for the glory of God and for work in this kingdom. know, it takes courage in you. Because God tells us to say things that we don't always want to say. Amen. Let's read. Jesus went into the Mount of Olives. And early in the morning he came again into the temple, and all the people came unto him. And he sat down and taught them. And the scribes and the Pharisees brought unto him a woman taken in adultery. And when he had set her in their midst, they said unto him, Master, this woman was taken in adultery in the very act. Now Moses in the law commanded us that she should be stoned. But what saying thou? This they said, tempting him, that they might have to accuse him. But Jesus stooped down, and with his finger wrote on the ground, as though he heard them not. So when they continued asking him, he lifted up himself and said unto them, He that is without sin among you, let him first cast a stone at her. And again he stooped down and wrote on the ground. And they which heard it, being convicted by their own conscience, went out one by one, beginning at the oldest even unto the last. And Jesus was left alone and the woman standing in the midst. But Jesus had lifted up himself and saw no one but the woman. He said unto her, Woman, where are those thine accusers? Have no man condemned thee? She said, No man, Lord. And Jesus said unto her, Neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more.
Amen.
Then spake Jesus again unto them, saying, I am the light of the world.
Amen.
He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness,
Amen.
But shall have the light of life.
Amen.
That's John 8:1-12, isn't it? Father, we need a word. We need a word that can change our lives for the rest of our lives. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Put on those spiritual seatbelts. a facade dog. And if it costs anything to be a facade dog, that's a charge for simony.
Amen.
And there's some people who play the simony game. They pay a little money to get a position.
Amen.
You should be put in a position based on your gifts and callings and the will of God, not based on how much money you gave anybody on record or the hospital. Peter also used to play this "I'm more spiritual than you" game. That's why he got into so much trouble. He was always playing that game. But when it came time when Jesus was walking on the water and Peter jumped out there, "I'm going to walk on the water," that's because I'm more spiritual than you. I'm going to jump out here and walk on the water. When they had the great confession, Peter came out with a great confession because he wasn't sure everybody he was more spiritual than the rest of them. In the Bible, Jesus says to the disciples, "I never asked you to have a sword, but now if you got a sword, go get one." And two people come back with a sword. One of them is Peter, because he wanted to be more spiritual than everybody else.
Amen.
And when Jesus is taken in the garden, Peter's the one that cuts off mouth and ear. But the key to it is when Jesus is talking to the other disciples, and Jesus says to the other disciples in Matthew chapter 26, "One of you will deny me." And this is how we know Peter was playing that game. He said, "Not me. I'll never do it. I'm more spiritual than the rest of them. They might deny me, but I'm not going to deny you." And Jesus looks at him and said, "Well, you hear this, before the cock crows, you're going to deny me three times."
Amen.
There are all kinds of games. I used to like the Easter game. I call it the Easter game. It's who sat in my seat at Easter service. Y'all ever play that game? I used to watch to see who sat in whose seat when I was a boy. Church games. There's that my way or the highway game. I'll support it if it goes my way, but I won't support it if it doesn't go my way.
Amen.
I'll pay for it if I agree with it, but I won't pay for it if I didn't go for it.
Amen.
And then there's the gossiping game. I'm not gossiping. I'm just telling you this because I want you to pray to me. I'm not gossiping. I know it's not gossip. I'm just telling you because I want you to pray with me.
Amen.
Brother and sister need some help.
Yeah.
And then here's the one that really kind of gets the preachers. I can't find the time to praise God in my house, but in the middle of the worship service, I'm going to come and take over.
Amen.
Now let the Holy Spirit use you. You can praise God anywhere you want to praise God. But if you can't find time to praise God in your house, don't come up in here and take up the whole worship service praising the Lord when you want to praise Him in your house. Get your praise in first in your house. Then you can come and do whatever God tells you to do.
Amen.
truth and love.
Amen.
It's hard.
Yes.
When you're the board me.
Amen.
Steward me.
Amen.
Trustee me.
Amen.
To look at the game players.
Amen.
And speak the truth and love.
Trying to trip Jesus up. When his disciples were out, they said, why do your disciples break the law and eat with others?
never used a sermon topic, deadly church games. Never used it. Never been on that subject. I think God is doing something special. He's doing something special. He wants to elevate us to a place that most churches can't go. I went to a church. I thought I was done. I guess I'm not done. I went to a church. They sent me there. And you get a little handful of people on Sunday morning. But on Monday board meeting, parking lot full. Everybody at the board meeting. I said, well, why does everybody come to the board meeting? They like the drama. Like the fights. And that was the culture of that church. So I was there about 6 months and board meeting and nobody there. I said, where everybody is? Well, everybody fights. So they quit coming. That's how board meetings ought to be in there. If you're coming for the fight, you're in the wrong church. If you're coming to get some business done, you're in the right church. And we should be able to invite the newest convert to our board meeting and say, look how we conduct business. We're doing the business of the Lord here. Look how saints work with each other. Look how they cooperate. Look how careful they are with what they're doing. How much fear of the Lord, reverence they give to every action. Look how they look thoughtful before they speak so that they don't hurt anybody needlessly. Like you hurt some people, but don't hurt them needlessly.
Amen.
That's where we're going. I hope the board meetings will be filled, but not because of deadly church games.
Amen.
Now we're going to open the doors of the church. We just stand, we're going to send an invitation to you and to you and to you to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior. He won that game so you can have a right to the tree of life. Will you come? Will you come?
Is there one?
Hey, Bluffton, you know, you've been on your books and supplies, but you've been tutor a person for zero. You already paid for life. You already paid for AC. So you could think you start a tutoring program if we had enough volunteers. I'm just giving that as an example. And many of the ministries are that way, but we can change choirs or add choirs. We volunteers. Habitat for Humanity has reached out to us. They said they're reaching out to 12 churches, and we're one of them. I'm waiting on, they gave you a phone call, I'm waiting on a letter. That counselor's in writing. All they need is someone gonna help, right? If I had a hand, it doesn't cost any money to do a lot of ministry. Doesn't cost money to say a cheerful word. Doesn't cost money to help someone in trouble, to walk a mile with them. So it's going to take some volunteers. But we're not looking at coming up with this expensive thing. Now, the more volunteers, the more money we'll put in that direction. So if someone's taking off with their ministry and doing great things, then the church will put money in that direction, but we're not looking at just spending a bunch of money. We're looking at filling in the gaps. I think we need another adult ministry. Again, I'm just with the church folks. I think we need that. I think we need a lot more done by young people. Some of their hearts out there today. Amen. I'd love to see, it may not happen, but I'd love to see a married couple ministry. That's something I do. I'd love to see a married couple's ministry, a singles ministry, if we have a need and volunteers and people want to do that. And those things don't cost a lot of money. That costs a lot of money to put a bunch of married people in the room and talk about what worked for you and what didn't work for you. Get all lovey-dovey. That can cost a lot of money. So that's the idea, because I heard some people say, well, where are we going to get the money? We don't have enough money now. Well, I'm not saying to do a lot of things that are expensive. And the other thing I found is we started ministering to the neighborhood, they started ministering to us. Amen? So we got that clear. All hearts, souls, and minds are clear. Just a short hand. Let's just give everyone that worked in the service to this good around.
Yeah.